Week 5, Session 2, you've just received the Hebrew Epistles, the additional notes. It's the goal and structure of the Hebrew Epistles, and I trust that will be helpful with the lesson that we've just covered. We're going to do the last lesson now, the Bible at a glance, where I'm going to take everything that we've done for now and basically repeat it, everything we've done over the last 4.5 weeks, and we're going to repeat it in a half an hour. Okay, that's the plan. Okay. 2 Timothy chapter 3 in your Bible, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 to 17 in your Bible says, and you got it on the notes there, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. Okay? So, all Scripture that God has given by inspiration, that God breathed, is given by inspiration, and it's profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and righteousness. Why? So that the man of God, that is each one of you, not just the men here, the man is male and female, but the man of God is the saint, the believer, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. What is going to furnish you and what's going to equip you for every good work is the Scripture, God's Word, okay? And God's Word is designed in a certain way so it can instruct you and it's going to tell you how to study it. We have all the Scriptures now, and you've seen we're talking about the Israel and prophecy and talking about the body of Christ and the mystery. For you to know God's Word and to be equipped unto every good work, you need to study it, okay? Which is our next point there. You need to rightly divide the Word of truth. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God. Why do you need to be approved unto God? Because only an approved workman do the work of the ministry. Okay? You need to show approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, if God tells me to study His Word, to show myself approved unto God, so that I needeth not to be ashamed, it also tells me I need to rightly divide the word of truth. That implies to me that if I don't rightly divide the word of truth, I am in error because I will wrongly divide the word of truth. Would you agree with me? Now, if God tells me to rightly divide the word of truth, surely He will tell me how and when and where to rightly divide it. He's not going to just leave it up to my device to rightly divide it. Somewhere in the Scripture He's going to tell me, you need to take these divisions in the Scriptures and you need to take note of these divisions. Okay? What is right dividing the Word of Truth? It is recognizing the natural divisions and the distinctions that God has placed in His Word. The Bible will lay itself out in Ephesians 2 according to God's simple threefold outline through the Pauline epistles. Now, I don't know why this thing is so slow. It's not working like it should be working, okay? First of all, we have time past. Ephesians chapter 2, and if, I'll just turn with my Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2. It's not on your notes there, the passage is there, but Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 11 says, wherefore remember that ye, that is you Gentiles, the church now, the body of Christ, wherefore remember that ye Gentiles, being in times past, Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time, in time past, at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. So in time past, according to the Scriptures, Gentiles were aliens and strangers. from the Commonwealth of Israel. There was a middle wall of partition between Israel and the Gentiles. Abraham's seed and Israel was the one that God was working through and with, and the Gentiles were on the other side of the middle wall of partition. That is time past. Time past, the subject was prophecy. The prophecy, what God prophesied was going to do, and it's concerning the kingdom that's been prophesied since the world began. Time passed. You with me? Now, you've heard this already, okay? The books of what we see in these books is Genesis to Malachi, Matthew to John, and the Acts, especially the first half of Acts. They all fall in what? Time passed, and they got to deal with the nation of Israel. Middle wall of petitioning, a division. Gentiles, angels, aliens, and strangers. It's the kingdom, okay? And then what happens? Jesus Christ comes. When did Jesus Christ die? In but now or in time past? He died in time past, okay? Between Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, at the end of that and the beginning of Acts, he died, okay? Then we have the second part, what he tells us, is in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 13 in the same chapter. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Who's you now? Who were far off? Gentiles. Now you are made what? Nigh. The middle wall of partition is broken down. There is no more a middle wall of partition because there's no more Jew nor Gentile in this body. Okay, in the but now. It's the dispensation of grace. Capital D, capital O, capital G, dog. You're the big dog now, the body of Christ. In time, with a small dog, the dog that fit the crumbs that forms from the master's table, but now you're the big dog. Okay? It's called, and but now it's called the mystery, a secret that God hid in himself since the foundation of the world. And Romans to Philemon deals with that. The ages to come, Ephesians 2, verse 7, that in the ages to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. The ages to come is God's going to fulfill his plan of redemption and restoration of both realms, heaven and earth. God's going to redeem his people over the earth, the nation of Israel, and the body of Christ, you and I, in the ages to come in the heavens. Prophecy will be fulfilled. The middle wall of petition in the ages to come will be up again. Prophecy will be fulfilled. The nation of Israel is going to be the people that God's going to deal with. Prophecy being fulfilled. And the books of Hebrews to Revelation deals with that. I don't know why this thing is doing that. It's giving me a hassle. Okay, so let's go there. Time passed. In time past, there was a division in humanity. Okay, it was a division in humanity. The Old Testament, Genesis to Malachi, is in time past. Who knows what Romans 15 verse 4 says? Those things were written aforetime were written for our what? Learning that we through the comfort and the patience of the Scriptures might have hope. Genesis to Malachi, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, beginning, they are written for our what? Learning, okay, and there's some stuff that we learn from there, but they deal with the nation of Israel, the circumcision people. It deals with the covenants and promises, okay? It's the Abrahamic covenant that is at play in time past. What is the Abrahamic covenant? I'm going to make you a great nation. I'm going to bless your seed. I'm going to give you a land. I'm going to give you a kingdom, right? And through you, the Gentiles will be, the nations of the world will be what? Blessed. I will bless them that bless you, but I will curse them that curses you. Okay? After you and I, the body of Christ, every nation today, let me tell you something. Let me warn some nations today. Every nation today that's going to be against Israel, and is against Israel today, is most probably going to be against Israel when you and I get taken out of this place. Those nations need to be very, very careful, because when Jesus Christ comes and he does the judgment of the nations, according to Matthew chapter 25, those nations will not go into the kingdom. They will be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord. They will go to the eternal lake of fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Okay? Israel is a special people. The law in time past was of Moses was added and fortified the middle wall of partition. Okay? It fortified the middle wall of partition. The Gentiles were the uncircumcision. They were aliens. They were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, angels and strangers. Okay? Genesis chapter 17 talks about the uncircumcised will be cut off from Israel. Leviticus 20 says the law separated Israel from the other people, from the Gentiles. Numbers 23:8-9 says Israel was a separate from the nations. There's a middle wall of partition up. Okay? What was the goal in the Old Testament? What was the goal? The goal was a kingdom prepared from the foundation of the world, according to Matthew 25, verse 34. Jeremiah 23, and the prophecy says, talks about a coming king. Daniel 2, chapter 44, talks about a coming kingdom. Genesis to Malachi is concerning a physical, literal kingdom where God's going to reclaim His authority back on the earth, and He will reign with the nation of Israel in that. That's all part of time past. The four Gospels in time past, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it is still part of the prophetic program. It's still part of time past. The middle wall of partitioning is still up. Romans 15 verse 8 says, Jesus Christ was a minister of the what? Circumcision. When Paul says Jesus Christ was, he doesn't say Jesus Christ is. He was a minister of the circumcision. That tells me, Paul says, when Christ in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, He was ministering to the nation of Israel. Jesus Himself said so. I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But Israel has a special status. It's still part of the Abrahamic covenant, as we see Matthew open up and Mark open up and Luke open up and John open up. Okay, Israel is still a special status. God, in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is calling out a remnant, a little flock from the nation of Israel, okay? To become the little flock, the true Israel of God. The goal in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is to establishment of the Messiah's kingdom on the earth. Time had come for prophecy to be what? Because what is the message in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at what? Hand. It's right there in reach. Get ready. Your king is here. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Your Christ, your Messiah is here. That was the goal there. The division in humanity was still there. Jesus was a minister of Israel. Matthew 1:21, He came to save His people from their sins. Okay? And John chapter 1 verse 11, He came into His own received Him not. Israel was God's people. The kingdom is at hand, and there's a wrath to come. Remember when John the Baptist was baptizing in Matthew chapter 3, and the scribes and the Pharisees and the priests came to him there, and He says, Who has warned you, O generation of vipers? Who have warned you from the wrath to flee from the wrath to come? What is John saying? You need to accept this message to flee the wrath to come, for God to protect you. The book of Acts is a transitional book, but it starts off still in times past. It ends in the but now, but it starts in times past, and it's going to transition from prophecy to what? Prophecy to what? Mystery. The book of Acts is still in times past. Israel stumbled at the cross, but they did not fall in early Acts. They actually fell by Acts chapter 7, which is fairly early, but by mid-Acts, Israel has fallen, okay? But in the beginning of Acts, God is offering the nation of Israel still. He's still offering them the king and a kingdom, okay? They ask, are you going to restore the kingdom again? It's at the return of Jesus Christ to take the sin of the nation of Israel away. That's what's been happening in the beginning of Acts. It still talks about you are the children of the covenants and the children of the prophets. The beginning of Acts. Still in time past. Still the middle wall of petitioning. Salvation to the Gentiles then comes by the middle of Acts through the fall of Israel and the diminishing of Israel in the last half of the book of Acts. The most basic division in God's Word that you can make is not between Old Testament and New Testament. The most basic division in God's Word that you can make and should be making is between prophecy and between mystery. The one was made known since the world began, Acts chapter 3, verse 19 to 21, and the other one was a secret since the world began, which is Romans chapter 16, 25, and there's a couple other passages too, in Ephesians chapter 3 and Colossians chapter 1. You with me? That is a division, the most basic division that you can make between time past and the but now. But now, there is no division, okay? It's the Pauline epistles will tell you about the but now. What's happening in the but now? It's regarding the body of Christ and God's purpose for the heavenly places. The but now deals with, in the beginning God created the heaven and the what? Earth. Everything from Genesis chapter 1 verse 2, right through the Old Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, early Acts is all about the earth, the kingdom, the establishment of the kingdom. When you come to Paul's epistles and Paul gets saved and he gets revealed the revelation of the mystery, it's not about the kingdom on the earth. It's in spite of that kingdom, he's talking about a group of people, the body of Christ that God's calling out to take into the heavenlies and to reclaim his authority back in the heavenly places. And by the way, how long will you be in for heaven? In heaven? It's for 7 years so you can come back for 1,000 years? Or will you be in heaven forever? Eternally in the heaven, God's plan before the foundation of the world that He hid in Himself. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13 to 16. Look at that passage there. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13 to 16. But now in Christ Jesus, He who sometimes were far off, that's the Gentiles, that's the body of Christ now, are made nigh by the blood of Christ, for He is our peace. Let me ask you, is He your peace? Have you trusted Him that you can say that He's your peace because you're made nigh by the blood of Christ? That you don't have to come through national Israel and bless Israel, become circumcised, follow Israel's program for you to have a relationship with God, but you can have a relationship with God in spite of the nation of Israel through the finished work of the cross, who made you nigh by the blood of the cross, has broken down the middle of partition between us. There's no more middle wall of partition. Having abolished in His flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments, the laws nailed to the cross, contained in ordinances, for to make of Himself of twain, Jew and Gentile, one new man, so making peace, and that He might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. Whew! That's a mouthful, but that's a blessed message. No division. In time past, there was a distinction between the Jew and the Gentile, but no more, okay? There's no longer a distinction. Romans chapter 3, verse 22 says, there is no difference. Romans 10, verse 12 to 13, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greeks. Between the Jew and the Greek. Galatians 3, 28, there is neither Jew nor Greek. Why? Because you're all one in Christ Jesus. Nobody has a special place. I am no better in God's eye and have no more better privileged place than what Jerry has there. And I know you guys think I'm a much better guy and a much, you know, better looking, just more, you know, than Jerry, you know. But we equal in Christ. I am blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He's blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You're blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You same blessing, nobody gets more. We're all equal in Christ. It's what we do with that blessing and our response and our choice that we make regarding that blessings that God has blessed us with. God's plan is for the people on earth and for heaven, the Gentiles, formerly aliens and strangers and dogs. He now shows the exceeding riches of His grace and the unsearchable riches of Christ. Ours now, in spite of Israel. Now, in this time of His grace that we live in, for God to call you complete in Christ, He calls you holy, holy, unblameable, and unreprovable in His sight. He's made you and I accepted in the Beloved. Everything God's work that He's done for us. All we had to do is trust Him and accept what He's given us. I'm not subject to the law to keep the law. And if I'm not getting blessed, if my grass is not growing, and if I got fungus in my shower, it's because I'm failing God in the law. No, I'm not working under that circumstances and operation anymore. If I got fungus in my shower, it's because I don't clean in my shower. But if Israel in time past they had fungus in their showers, it's because they were not obeying the law, the conditional contract that they enter in with God. I am not under a conditional contract. I'm standing fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made me free. The law is nailed to the cross and taken out of the way. I'm accepted in the Beloved. The but now has been kept secret since the world began. A secret that God has now revealed. Okay? The but now also has got to do with the secret coming of Christ at the end of the dispensation. Never been prophesied before. Never talked about from Genesis to Malachi. Never talked about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Never talked about the book of Acts. And now suddenly we learn through Romans to Philemon, there's a secret coming for Him. He's going to come us and snatch us and take us out of this world. And what He's going to do is He is going to clothe us with a new house. He says, for if we know in 2 Corinthians 5:1, for we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God and house not made with hands. How long? Eternal in the heavens. Eternal in the heavens. What is your hope for? To live eternity in the heavens? That's my hope. That's what the verse tells me. And I'm thankful for that. But now we come to the ages to come. In the ages to come, it's going to talk about the fulfillment of God's plan for heaven and earth, both of them. But first of all, it's the prophecy that's been fulfilled. Prophecy that needs to be fulfilled. It is the Hebrew epistles, Hebrews through Revelation, that prophecy that needs to be fulfilled. Romans chapter 11, 25 to 27. We read that earlier to you. God is not finished with Israel. All Israel shall be saved. And when, by the way, when He says all Israel shall be saved, does that mean every Israelite that's walking the planet will be saved? Or when He says all Israel, is all Israel that needs to be saved? That needs to be saved. Okay. Acts chapter 2, the last verses in Acts chapter 2 tells you that. Okay. He warns Israel in the Matthew and in the book of Matthew that if they don't, they're going to go with those nations that opposes Israel. When he says that these my brethren, he's talking about the little flock. They are the true Israel of God. They are all the Israel of God that God has, because not everybody that has been circumcised in the flesh and keeps the law is an Israelite, a true Israelite. You could be circumcised in the flesh. You can do the Sabbath days. You can do the whole thing like Israel did. That is an Israelite. God says a true Israelite is one that's circumcised in the heart, not in the flesh. But these prophecy books, they look at the Hebrew epistles, and they were written during the transition in the book of Acts. They're expecting the coming wrath. They're expecting the fulfillment of prophecy. They are very important books, Hebrews through Revelation, because they're talking to a future Jewish remnant. Israel's program resumes. Soon as you and I are taken out of the earth, God is restarting His prophetic program that is put on pause while this dispensation comes to the fullness. And then when you and I get taken out and caught up and are re-raptured, God is going to return His program with Israel to save all Israel, bring the kingdom in. And so these books, Hebrews to Revelation, is very important for the nation of Israel. There is a distinction in these books between the Jew and the Gentile in Hebrews to Revelation. We've gone through these verses. First began to be spoken by the Lord, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The world to come, the kingdom that's going to come in. James chapter 1 verse 12, the 12 tribes scattered abroad. Okay, the holy prophets, us, the apostles, James, Cephas, and John. Jesus Christ returns in power and glory to rule in His kingdom on earth. Go with me to Revelation chapter 19. We're almost done. Revelation chapter 19. You understand that there's so much in between. I'm giving you the skeleton in this 5 weeks. I'm providing you the skeleton of God's Word. You need to go home and go put the meat on there. Okay? But you have at least the overview. Now you can start building an understanding there. Okay? Revelation chapter 19, verse 11. I saw heaven opened, and behold a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as the flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped with blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Who do you think that is? Jesus Christ. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that it should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth his winepress of the fierceness and wrath of God, of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh the name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That is specifically speaking about the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Before he sits on that throne, before Israel gets blessed in that land, he's going to come to judge and make war first. You and I are not looking forward to that day. We escape the wrath of God. In ages to come, God is going to fulfill his plan for heaven and earth. God is always going to be faithful. God, we serve a faithful God. Faithful is God. And he's going to fulfill his plan for heaven and for the earth. He will fulfill his promises to Israel. He's going to redeem Israel. He's going to restore this world back unto himself. And he's going to take it out of the hand of Satan. And he's going to take that authority back. The God of this world is going to be thrown into the bottomless pit for 1,000 years. And he's going to take that authority back, and he's going to claim his authority back unto him. And the end of 1,000 years, he's going to release Satan for a season, and he's going to deceive even some of those nations that goes into the kingdom to stand against Christ and his anointed. And at the end of that 1,000 years of kingdom, he is going to have the final judgment take place there, the great white throne judgment. And Satan and everybody else will be in the eternal lake of fire, whose names are not found in the Lamb's Book of Life. He's going to restore that kingdom back to himself, but he will also fulfill his word to us, the body of Christ. He's going to be restoring the heavenly places, and he's going to glorify us together with his Son to show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus in the heavenly places. You and I are going to go in there and fulfill his purpose and plan there. By the middle of the 7 years of tribulation, Satan gets kicked out. In the book of Revelation, it tells us he gets kicked out in the middle of that 7 years of tribulation. He gets kicked out, and for 3.5 years, Satan has his day of wrath. He's angry when he comes kicked out from there. You and I, the body of Christ, who goes in the beginning of the 7 years of tribulation, gets going to the heavenly places. We take all those thrones and authorities and places over in the heavenly places. That's God's purpose. We'll be judging angels, says the Scriptures. You and I, the body of Christ, that's a privileged position to be at. There is time past, but now in ages to come. If you want to understand your Bible, you start with this. You understand the prophetic program. You understand the kingdom program. You understand the promises and the covenants and the prophecies. You understand the but now, and you understand the ages to come. When you have an understanding, now you can come to God's Word and you can study it and know it, because you're not going to be confused about where or what you fit in. If I have an envelope here and I put Bob's name in there and I seal it, and there's $1,000 for Bob, and it's made out to Bob, whatever your last name is now, I can't think of it now. Donaldson, Bob, Robert Donaldson, $1,000 sealed. And I write Robert Donaldson, and I put that up there. But old Tony there next to, he's an opportunist, and he says, there's some mail for Mr. Donaldson. I'm going to grab it. I'm going to go to the bank and say, hey, I am Tony, but here says Robert, I'm going to claim this for me. What are the bank going to tell him? It's not your mail, sir. It's not made out to you, and it doesn't belong to you. In the same way with us, you can't take Israel's mail and Israel's instructions and Israel's word and apply it to yourself and want to claim it for you. You can't go to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, if my people are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray, I will heal their land. He's not talking about the nation of Israel. He's talking about the land of Israel. Don't spiritualize the scriptures. For you to understand it and to know it, what you need to do to get this right, you have to study. You have to study to show yourself, thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Made the distinction between prophecy and mystery. Time past, but now and ages to come. Know which scriptures fit in where. Understand where they fit in. See your place and where you fit in. And function according to what God's call in your life is, and as the member of the body of Christ, and what He's doing with you. And fit in that program and understand who you are and what God has made you to be. And that way, you are building with gold, silver, and precious stones. You are not building with wood, hay, and stubble that will all be burnt up at the judgment seat of Christ. But you will build with materials that is concrete, that will stand for eternity, and will reward you in eternity. But to do that, you need to understand God's Word. This willy-nilly approach to God's Word, we need to stop it. Get and come serious with God's Word and understand what it is. Understand where you fit in. Understand God's program with Israel. Understand God's program with the body of Christ. Know where you are. Know where you fit in. And get on with the business that God has called us to do with. He has saved us unto all good works. And what furnishes all to all good Word is the Word of God. Making sense of the Bible. 5 hours. It was a little bit more than 5 hours. But basically 5 hours through the Scriptures. It was a wild ride up to now, right? It's a lot of information. It's almost like you have information overload. Like, But I promise you, as you go back and you go look at these things slowly, you go through the Scriptures and you read it, it will teach you. God says in His Word in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 7, now, I forgot what God's Word says. He's got understanding in all things. Okay. Consider what I say, and the Lord give the understanding in all things. Thanks. You go and consider it. Amen? Amen.